Subscribers, 60 views, a little ways to go in terms of reaching the potential group that we'd like to. However, a lot of good stuff happened this week. It's been a really active week as far as becoming new charter owners. We closed on our Lagoon 46, and also we may be going to the Annapolis Boat Show in a couple of months. Now, the best part about going to the Annapolis Boat Show is that Navigar, our charter partner, has offered to let me sail the boat from Annapolis all the way to the British Virgin Islands. And I'm really excited about that. I don't know if it's going to happen. It's a little early to be sure. We won't know, and it's August right now, and the show's in October. So our timelines are pretty tight because the boat's still in France. And for this to happen, the boat has to get fully commissioned. It's already left the factory, but commissioning also involves things like the rigging and getting everything set up. So it has to get fully commissioned, and then it has to get shipped from Bordeaux all the way to likely Norfolk on a ship, and then taken off, finalized, kind of just the final touches, and then it has to make its way from Norfolk up to Annapolis. Now, Joaquin, who I've mentioned before, who is my agent at Navigar, who sold me the boat, says they might ship the boat to Fort Lauderdale and try to sail it up from there. I'm not as big a fan of that plan. I think that that's a long way to go in hurricane season, kind of in the peak of hurricane season, and it sounds like it's a bit perilous. So I'm gonna probably vote no on the boat going to Fort Lauderdale and then coming up because of hurricanes. So let's start with the route. I love the Bahamas. The Bahamas are a huge part of this trip if we get to go down, and part of me wanted to keep the boat in the Bahamas. My reason for not doing so is how much longer the charter season is in the Virgin Islands. You've got an extra 2 or 3 months, there's more demand, and there's more of what a lot of charterers like to do. I'm more of a sailor. I mentioned this before. The boat is configured for sailing. We're ordering a spinnaker. The boat has a code zero. It's a sailing catamaran. It's not a racing catamaran. It's not a super high performance catamaran. It's a well performing cruising catamaran. And that's where my passions lie at this point. Being a part-time sailor, the ability to cross huge distances in the shortest period possible isn't quite as nice as having a lot of luxury for my wife and guests while we're there. And in this price range, around $1 million, if you were to look at performance catamarans, it's a pretty small boat. And you're not getting air conditioning, you're sleeping in an undersized bunk, you're really roughing it as far as I'm concerned. And there's nothing wrong with that. I think it's pretty awesome, you know, when you see people in the smallest Outremers really zipping along and able to sail in incredibly light winds and go in really shallow areas. That's fantastic. At some point, I might want to do more of that. I'd probably do it on a bigger performance cat if I was going to, but there's no real charter business for performance cats at this point. And this is a vehicle. It's an investment. We're offsetting all of our costs, basically owning this for free, and we get to sail it a lot, which is pretty awesome. That's why we're doing it. So that's the difference between charter ownership and a performance cat that you're a live aboard, and I've already mentioned how different that is than what we're attempting to do at this point. That being said, this is a pretty big journey. It's about 1,800 miles from Annapolis to Tortola, the way that I'd like to sail it. There are definitely faster routes. You could cut 500 miles off that trip pretty easily if you wanted to stare at the ocean the entire trip. That's not what I'd like to do on this trip. I'd like to go to a bunch of places that I haven't seen, stop off for a little bit while sailing most of the time. And I'm going to be working. Annie's going to be working. Now, how is this possible? Well, tomorrow my new Starlink antenna arrives. I've gone with the RV plan, and there are already a large number of places that are available right now, and people are already getting Starlink service in the Bahamas. It's unclear. Starlink still says the Bahamas are coming soon. However, I've been watching blogs, I belong to some Facebook groups, and I'm trying to figure all that out. But it looks like we should have pretty good internet most of the way down at Anchor. There's definitely internet all the way down the coast. We'll have really good internet. We probably will have no internet on our first crossing, which is likely to be from Hatteras, Cape Hatteras, the tip of Cape Hatteras, to Green Turtle. Green Turtle Cay is in the northern part of the Abacos. We've been there before. It's incredibly beautiful. It's rather rustic, and as some of you know or are aware, Dorian devastated that part of the Bahamas about 4 or 5 years ago now, and it's still recovering. So we like to go there and support the locals, first of all, but second, it's incredibly beautiful. So we'll probably first make landfall in the Bahamas at Green Turtle, assuming that the entries are good there, which I'll do a whole nother episode on crossing bars and what that's like in the Bahamas. Basically, these narrower entrances and cuts through the reefs, you need to have enough depth that the wave height is not breaking through the bar. Now, there's always Man of War, which is 25 feet deep, which is a pretty safe entrance in all but the worst of weather, and we won't be sailing there if it's the worst of weather, I can tell you that. But we'll head down from North Carolina. It's about a 3-day sail under the conditions we're likely to see, and it should be a fairly moderate entrance after that into Green Turtle. If not, we'll have to go to Marsh Harbor, and if things are really, really somehow awful, then you would sail on to Nassau and kind of take a break there. We don't intend to go to Nassau on this trip, but if there were really bad conditions, I might reprovision in Nassau before heading south. The idea is to sail inside of Eleuthera in the Exumas for a lot of the trip, which is, as everybody knows, gorgeous. Stop at the beach here, stop at the beach there, anchor, do some work. Annie and I both have the luxury of working remotely, so at least I can stay in touch and not be out of the loop for a full 3 weeks, which is how long I'm anticipating this trip will take. After that, we'll head from, it's unclear where exactly yet, Clarencetown or somewhere around there in the southern Bahamas, to possibly Turks and Caicos. That will be wind and guest dependent, and then on to the Dominican Republic, most likely the northern coast. Some people talk about sailing around the south side and going east or west of Haiti and then heading down and coming up the south side, which is supposed to be exquisite. However, I think that'll probably be a big waste of time for us and likely result in less efficient sailing. There are some good ports on the northern coast. We might hit Punta Cana. Again, this will depend on our guests and people's air travel plans. And then my plan at this point, based on the wind and likely prevailing waves, is to sail through the southern coast of Puerto Rico and then come up into likely St. Thomas, and then maybe have people flying back from St. Thomas, and then take the boat over to Tortola and get acquainted with our new partners down there for a couple of days before I fly back to the States, planning to return next in February. So I'll get hopefully about 3 weeks aboard, three exciting different weeks, and then head out and put our boat to work for the peak season before hopefully attending a really fun race, cruiser race in St. Martin in February. So it's kind of an abrupt ending to the video. There's actually about 20 minutes more of footage that I recorded this morning. But it's 12 hours later, actually 14 hours later. I've had some other work to do and I kind of got to stop here. I hope next week to pick up a lot. I talk a lot about fuel efficiency, the engines, running times, things of that nature. Who knows what next week will hold in store. Hopefully I have a lot more information about whether or not this great trip's actually going to happen, or whether I'm going to first meet the Bella Giornata in Tortola in the beginning of November. Stay tuned.